morning.
Good morning.
We're so glad to have you with us this morning. We have the delightful event of our campus minister, Dr. Olga Maria Cruz, preaching for us today. We are thrilled to have her bringing the word to us, so get excited. And that also gives us the opportunity, Pastor Greg and I, to spend some time in the balcony. This morning at the 8:30 service, I was up there, he's up there for this one. We're learning more about how the camera system works and how to run the live stream. Just making sure that more than one of us knows how to do that. Josh is doing an amazing job, but we don't want to leave him hanging. And so if any of you would be interested in learning how that works, it turns out it's pretty simple. I managed to follow the whole time. And so, yeah, if you're interested in that, let us know. But we'll be trained up soon. But yes, let us get into worship this morning. I invite you to stand as you are able for the Thanksgiving for baptism. Alleluia. Christ is risen. In the waters of baptism, we have passed over from death to life with Jesus Christ, and we are a new creation. For this saving mystery and for this water, let us bless God, who was, who is, and who is to come. We thank you, God, for your river of life, flowing freely from your throne, through the earth, through the city, through every living thing. You rescued Noah and his family from the flood. You opened wide the sea for the Israelites. Now in these waters you flood us with mercy, and our sin is drowned forever. You open the gate of righteousness, and we pass safely through. In Jesus Christ you calm and trouble the waters. You nourish us and enclose us in safety. You call us forth and send us out. In lush and barren places you are with us. You have become our salvation. Now breathe upon this water and awaken your church once more. Claim us again as your beloved and holy people. Quench our thirst, cleanse our hearts, wipe away every tear. To you, our beginning and our end, our shepherd and lamb, be honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving, now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. O God of life, you reach out to us amid our fears with the wounded hands of your risen Son. By your Spirit's breath, revive our faith in your mercy and strengthen us to be the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
First reading is a reading from Acts. When they had brought the apostles, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name, yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you're determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things. And so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The second lesson is a reading from Revelation. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne. And for Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth, to him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he's coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty, the Word of the Lord.
Gospel according to John from the 20th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written, so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Good morning, friends. I'm so glad to be with you. This day last year, I preached for the first time from this pulpit, and Jeremy recorded it on his phone. No one else was here. And I have to say, it feels a little bit like resurrection just to be able to stand here and see your faces. As most of you know, I am a staff member here at Grace. I direct Welcome, Winthrop's Ecumenical Lutheran Campus Ministry. And in that role, I get to serve at the intersection of my two favorite social institutions, the church and the university. As some of you might know, I didn't grow up in church. I found my way to faith as an adolescent. I grew up a professor's kid, more connected to the realm of academia. And one thing I've noticed that both these institutions have in common is their tendency to focus on the life of the mind or the spirit, to center on ideas, concepts, facts. The church does well at making some space for feelings, but when it comes to the body, many intellectual and spiritual institutions seem to prefer to ignore or even deny it. Maybe it's Plato's fault, that most influential of Greek philosophers, who taught that the body and the psyche were separate and not at all equal. He saw the spirit as far superior to the body, but Jesus is having none of that. Maybe it's St. Paul's fault, who had certainly been exposed to Plato's ideas. More likely, the thinkers and preachers who over the years read both Plato and Paul have come away with the idea that the spirit is to be prized and the flesh despised. But Jesus is having none of that. Maybe it's just that bodies are messy. We get uncomfortable with how obviously vulnerable we all are once we realize we're walking around in these beautiful, highly sophisticated, also rather awkward bags of mostly water. We prefer to ignore the body, try to sidestep some of that vulnerability. In fact, most of us have probably experienced some Christian teaching, or I should say teaching that claimed to be Christian, that made us feel shame for even having a body. But Jesus is having none of that. We may be tempted sometimes to try to pray away our ailments or our emotional distress. We may be tempted to try to use our spirituality to bypass the suffering life sometimes hands us. But Jesus is having none of that. Jesus comes to us in the ultimate frailty of newborn flesh. As the Word made flesh, Jesus disrupts the dualistic idea that the body is a problem. In his earthly life, he experienced hunger, thirst, fatigue, and pain in his body. He labored for over a decade as a carpenter, after all. The Bible doesn't tell us much about it, but we can imagine. Hammers, thumbs, splinters. And Jesus ministered to people not just through preaching ideas or telling stories, which would have been hard to do without a body, by the way. Jesus didn't come to transcend or judge or ignore other people's bodies either. He walked and fished and slept beside them, ate and drank with them. Jesus touched people's bodies. He fed them, healed them. He washed their feet. It's not in the texts, but I'm guessing he probably danced at that wedding in Cana. Jesus also experienced emotions in his body. P.S., I was this many years old when I learned that in English we call emotions feelings because we feel them. They arise as physical sensations in our bodies. And we know Jesus laughed and wept. He felt and expressed anger and grief. Disappointment. Jesus experienced fully for himself and with his companions all the same human vulnerabilities that we experience. And Easter Sunday, in a way Thomas and the disciples come to understand in this dramatic encounter, the resurrection of Christ, is the triumph not just of the spirit over death, but the redemption of the flesh. Jesus is not there bleeding all over the floor. His wounds have healed, yet he still bears the marks, and he's willing to share them with Thomas. Jesus is willing not just to be seen but touched, to be comprehended close up. He is not covering up the damage that was done to him. He chooses to own it and to share that vulnerability as a pathway to connection with these followers who have stuck around or, like Thomas, come back. Christ's wounds are a pathway of connection for Thomas and by extension for us. Thomas is suffering some disconnection from community and from God because he's confused as to what God is doing and where he fits into it. But Jesus makes the first move to meet Thomas where he is, with what he needs to move forward in faith and service. I find in this text an invitation to acknowledge the vulnerability we each have to illness, to fatigue, to aches and pains, to aging, if we're lucky, an invitation to acknowledge the scars we bear from surgeries, from injuries, from chicken pox on. Anybody else? Chicken pox scars? And the vulnerability we have to trauma and to death. Jesus knows this vulnerability. He took it on himself, and he's willing to share it with us as a way of helping us connect with God. Jesus appears in these days and weeks after Easter in his same physical body, still fully God, still fully human. There were those, and have been all along, who would deny the full humanity of Jesus. But human bodies are the pinnacle of God's creation, which God called very good. The human body is where God came to meet us in the person of Jesus. And in his resurrection body, Jesus witnesses to us that God's love is powerful enough to accompany us in, carry us through, and receive us at the end of all our sufferings. God's love is able to redeem our suffering and transform it into connection. Suffering, both ours and Christ's, is real, but it's not the end of the story. Dr. Mary Hinkle Shore points out that in this passage, Jesus shows up and keeps showing up in, quote, a body that holds together the worst that has happened to him and his risen life. Jesus' scars speak peace to me. They remind me I am not alone in my sufferings or my questions, which can tend to isolate and disconnect us. A student asked me recently about the meaning of suffering and why God allows it. I told her we could spend all semester unpacking that beautiful and important question. But for this moment, perhaps it is helpful to start by noticing that suffering can be a pathway to connection. When I can acknowledge my pain, I can hand it over to God's care. When I can acknowledge that others share in my suffering, I know I am not alone, and my problems are placed in their true perspective. There is no situation too difficult to be bettered. There is no unhappiness too great to be lessened when we lean into community, when we lean into God's presence and receive God's peace, as Jesus offers Thomas and the disciples in this locked room. And Jesus' scars speak peace to me as they point toward the hope of our own resurrection. The resurrection of the body in Christ offers me hope and makes meaning of my suffering. It points me to the deeper reality that God is making all things new, starting with Jesus' body and eventually yours and mine, and the whole of creation. And we can grow in our ability to trust God's resurrection power to transform our minds and hearts, as well as our bodies. God's love can break in behind locked doors. God's peace can reach even a frosty heart or a closed mind. And we can encounter God not only in the realm of ideas or spirit, but in our bodies. We can worship God with our bodies, even in the midst of suffering. We can pause and notice this breath and this one. You can feel your heart beating, can feel your feet on the floor, and name them as a gift from God. Maybe we can notice our feelings. Oh, a little grief arising again in my throat or behind my sternum. Hello, grief, old friend. See if you can name them. Offer your feelings a chance to rest in God's compassion. Maybe we can even notice discomfort or pain in our bodies as we sit in this moment, as we come forward for communion, and in those twinges, those aches, find reassurance, an indication that God is slowly calling each of us home. We can lean into community by reaching out to others who also have bodies, by the way, to walk together, to cook together, play golf together, worship together. We can build communities around feelings that need support or ailments that impede our joy. And if others can find help and support in community and the presence of Christ as Thomas did, so can we. God is making all things new. Minds and hearts and bodies, yours and mine. God is making all things new. And this resurrection is for all of us. Thanks be to God. With the whole church, let us confess our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father.
He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Set free from captivity to sin and death, we pray to the God of resurrection for the church, people in need, and all of creation. Holy One who acts righteously, equip your church as witnesses of your goodness to go and tell others of your abundant love, that they may believe that Jesus is our salvation and life. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Renew your people's commitment to use resources responsibly and to live well with your creation. Invite us to recognize and nurture signs of resurrection life in the natural world. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Direct those who are given human authority to lead with humility and compassion. By your Holy Spirit, channel their attention towards serving those who are most in need. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Uphold your children who cry out to you, especially Donna, Sarah, Carlo, Sue, Mary, Eddie, John, Michelle, Austin, Joyce, Nancy, Robin, Jim, Pat, Emily, Sylvia, Steve, Kay, Eric, Mary, Bill, Earl, Barbara, Kathy, and Ted. Wherever people are overcome by the fear of death, breathe into them your life and peace. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Inspire those who lead your people in worship and praise. With joyful motion and sound, send us forth with praise that we cannot keep to ourselves. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us the words of your saints who, like Thomas, boldly confessed your Son as Lord and God. With Jesus our leader, empower us to live according to his ways. God, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In your mercy, O God, respond to these prayers and renew us by your life-giving Spirit. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Also with you.
We invite you to share a sign of that peace with those around you. And if you're worshiping with us from home, we invite you to share that peace with someone you're with or give someone a call and share God's peace with them. You may be seated. This time we give thanks for the gift that is you and the communities and the connections that you make up. We are so glad for the many ways that we connect, as Dr. Cruz spoke about our connections in our communities. And one of our special ones is our welcome community, and this week is exam week. And so we invite you to make an offering of your prayers this week for our students and all the students at Winthrop who are doing exams and finishing up papers, and we just want to hold them in our thoughts and prayers this week. And now we continue with the offering of the anthem.
Oh,
Let us pray together. Living God, you gather the wolf and the lamb to feed together in your peaceable reign, and you welcome us all at your table. Reach out to us through this meal and show us your wounded and risen body, that we may be nourished and believe in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord, for he is the true Passover Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. On the night in which he was handed over, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven,
the risen Christ dwells with us here. All who are hungry, all who are thirsty, come. You may be seated. For communion this morning, we will begin with our worship assistants and our choir, and then we invite you to come down the center aisle, kneel or stand as you prefer. If you need gluten-free, please let us know, and if you would prefer a blessing, let us know, and then return on the side aisles. And if you would prefer that we come to you, simply stay in your seats and give us a little wave at the end. Let us receive the sacrament.
Thank you.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Let us pray together. We give you thanks, generous God, for in this bread and cup we have tasted the new heaven and earth, where hunger and thirst are no more. Send us from this table as witnesses to the resurrection, that through our lives all may know life in Jesus' name. Amen. A scheduling announcement this week. We were supposed to have seniors at Grace. That is being postponed due to a COVID situation. So no seniors at Grace this week. Hopefully we'll get to do that activity again at a later time. But that information and all other information that you may need to know is in the Grace Notes e-news that comes out on Tuesday. So be sure to be looking for that. And if you would like to be added to that email list, please fill that out on your chair and chair. We'd love to share that information with you. And now receive God's blessing. Almighty God, the author of life, Christ, the living cornerstone, and the life-giving spirit of adoption, bless you now and forever. Amen.
Done.
Thanks be to God.